So I'm going to talk to you about computational modeling as a supermicroscope to materials of future. And to start with, what do these have in common? So there is cooking oil. There is gluing things together under water. There is polymer materials with unusual temperature response. There is soap bubbles. Egg-based mayonnaise. So the regular mayonnaise, that's lecithin-stabilized vegetable oil emulsions. Then we have fish slime. We have self-cleaning surfaces for different applications. Triggered drug release for specifically eye diseases, also some other things. Soggy, wet cardboard. What does that have common with the others? Biological cell membranes. Harvesting fatty acid producing algae cultures. Reducing inflammation in artificial joints. That's antimicrobial coatings at biological interfaces. Ferromagnetic fluids patterns. Clogging deposit in crude oil pipes in oil fields. HIV, influenza virus and their entry to biological cells. Microbe-produced cell fibers. So what is the common factor here? These are all materials and topics that I have so far computationally modeled in my research. These are also all soft materials. My field is soft materials, specifically soft matter modeling. I use computers and computer simulations to study this kind of things, and also many other things. So, I do materials modeling. Why materials? Why especially soft materials? First of all, materials are everywhere. They are here in this hall. They are here in this building. We are made of materials. The entire society, it relies on materials. It's quite crucially important that we actually have materials. Then, because of resource efficiency, we actually need novel material solutions. We need them for sustainability. We need them for competitiveness. This is increasingly evident with the sustainability crisis and with the environmental concerns that the world is undergoing. My field is soft materials. All bio-based materials are soft materials. That actually makes soft materials very important for the materials of future. Okay. Then there is a beautiful picture at the right-hand side of this slide. It's phospholipid assemblies in vegetable oil and at an oil-clay mineral surface interface. Depending on how much water, what type of lipids those are specifically, this is either a bio-oil, bio-based fuel, pharmaceutical lotion, so hand lotion, or an emulsion such as the mayonnaise that I mentioned. This is a picture by my recently graduated doctoral student about her research. Okay. So then, why soft? Soft is bio-based and sustainable. Besides that, it also has the fanciest new possibilities for advanced materials. I gave some examples as the first slide. One key to soft being great is that it actually is soft. It deforms and changes. This actually allows soft to have living-inspired properties. For example, adapting to stimuli and responding to that. Here, there is an example from a recently published by me and collaborators perspective article about materials that sense make decisions based on the stimuli they sense and then respond to that. For example, the soft material thing there at the slide, sensing environment, then deciding to contract around the gray sphere, trapping it. Quite a bit applications for that kind of materials. Okay. Another example is interactive with environment dynamical materials that via the chains obtain new properties. This allows properties such as memory, programmability of the feedback response, so materials that react to what they sense, sensing-based movement, things like actuation, soft robots, various different things. So quite fancy advanced material solutions by soft. Then I'm doing computational simulations. I simulate materials. Materials are made of molecules, such as those on the slide. I introduced to you a black box. This is my simulations. In this talk, we are not really going to go into detail what is ongoing there. Instead, I say that I need a model for interactions. And this comes from physics. At fundamental level, this is the Schrödinger equation and its approximations. It goes into the black box, defines the interactions of those molecules, how does the material behave. Then I need the molecule structures, the conditions such as temperature, pressure, what is the composition of the solution, what is there that I'm simulating. And what is coming out is a prediction for the molecule's response, the material's response. So this is what I do. I don't really have a microscope. I have a computer, processor, many processors. All are calculating, computing, solving the jiggles and wiggles of the molecules in the material. Okay. So then, why modeling? First, modeling is immensely more efficient than experimentation in terms of how much things can be probed. So screening is hugely efficient. One can go through vast variety of possibilities, and the money cost of the materials is significantly less. It allows deeper understanding via having higher control over what goes in and then detailed knowledge what is coming out. Accelerated product development via that, and then because the monetary costs are relatively low, the return on investment actually becomes very high. So profits can become very high. Okay. So many reasons why to do modeling. Then a couple of examples, what is it that I really do? This is a silk-like protein molecule. It has at the ends this kind of folded, like more or less spherical domains, the yellow and the green one on the slide. It's connected by a flexible chain in the middle. Okay. The curious thing about this molecule is that it actually makes many different kind of interesting materials, such as fibers, adhesives. There are a lot of interesting things coming out of this kind of materials. But then it can also be varied, so we can design the protein according to how the amino acid composition is or what the blocks there are at the block segment level. And now this can be done experimentally, but what I do, I can do it simulationally, and I have a highly efficient screening tool to go from A, B, C, D, go beyond like different characteristics there, and I can do it over a large variety of solution conditions, possibilities there. What does it look like in simulation? These are the proteins in a simulation box. There is a lot of them. They are in aqueous solution. Okay. And this is the type of information that I get out of the simulations. So the proteins are interacting there. They are moving. One can see which parts are going there, what are the dynamics, a lot of information coming out there. Okay. So, here are the proteins in a simulation box. this is the actual material from a collaborating group. And this is the droplet that I'm actually, the protein material that I'm actually simulating. So that solution droplet at the end of the pipette there. And this is the fiber that's produced from the protein solution. So I actually model a very tiny part of the actual solution, and it's crucial to have the experimental realization close by. Modeling on its own is rather limited in materials design. Then another example. This is a polymer material, polyelectrolyte material. The blue polymer chains there are positively charged polycationic polymers. The red ones have negative charge. And this type of polyelectrolyte thin films, they are used as surface protecting coatings. They are used as biointerfaces. They are used in encapsulating bioactive molecules, so in drug transport or in capturing pollutants. There is a vast variety of applications for this type of materials. I have studied this material quite a bit. This is my computer zooming into the material. One thing that we actually looked into this material is that it's undergoing a softening transition when it's heated up. And this softening transition, it's quite expectedly in a polymer material associated with the polymer chains moving more. But now this polymer material, it actually contains a lot of charges. And the charges there really like water. So there is quite a bit of water in the material as well. And what the computational techniques resolve, it's actually the water, where the water is how it is moving, that changes when the material is heated up. And that allows knowing what is the handle that we should use for tuning the material's properties. Quite unexpected, because usually it's considered that, okay, the chains start moving and that's it. But now we know that it's the water that really needs to be controlled. Okay. And this is actually a very easy handle for going to practical materials properties. Then, to summarize this talk, I hopefully was able to give you a couple of examples why soft really has the promise for really nice advanced future materials solutions. So soft materials are really super cool and worth putting time into. Then computational modeling. It can be a supermicroscoped materials allowing very efficient screening. It reveals mechanisms. I showed a couple of examples there. And then understanding via showing that what's really ongoing in the material. Okay. And there always should be experiments and an actual material there side by side with the modeling. Modeling is an enabler for advance in materials. Okay. So then the thanks and acknowledgements. I'm giving here a talk for a professor position in the field of soft materials modeling. The soft materials modeling, it's actually the name of my research group. And this position is relatively new, so the group has been quite a while before the position. So I should thank my group, the past and the present, the people who have been equally excited about soft matter modeling as I am. Okay. And then there are the collaborators, the people who have the real materials, the people who do theory, the people who do simulations on related topics. And thanks them as well. Okay. And then the copyrights and preferences of the talk. Thank you. Thank you.